man insane. You broke my will, but what a thrill. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. I let you love what I thought it was funny. You came along and moved me, honey. I changed my mind, this world is mine. It's just great balls of fire. Kisses, baby. Feels good. Hold me, baby. Well, I want to love you like I love a shoe. You're fine, so kind. Got to tell this world that you're mine. Got you my nails and I twist all my thumbs. I'm real on earth, but it sure is fun. Holy baby, well, I often love you like I love a should. You're fine, so kind. Got to tell this world that you're mine. Ain't you trying to kill that I squint on my thumb? Real nervous, but it sure is fun. Come on, baby, drive crazy. But this great, great ball of fire.
ABC Sports presents live in its 30th anniversary season, the Professional Bowlers Tour. Today from Torrance, California, it's the AC Delco Classic. First up, Rookie of the Year, Ricky Ward. He'll face the PBA career earnings leader, Marshall Holman. That winner will face third-seeded PBA president, Mark McDowell. Then the 1988 Rookie of the Year, Rick Steelsmith. Our tournament leader is 17-time PBA champion, Wayne Webb. That's our outstanding field of finalists for today's Professional Bowlers Tour telecast. If you were a history purist, you could trace the origins of bowling to primitive man. Or you could point to evidence that the ancient Egyptians were the first bowlers, followed by the Greeks, and then the Romans. But what about the history of bowling in the New World? The first permanent area dedicated to the sport of bowling was probably on this very spot, a lawn called Bowling Green. This park, permanently preserved, is situated in the very heart of New York's vast, hectic, and busy financial district, located at the southernmost tip of Manhattan Island. The price of access to Bowling Green is a mere peppercorn. You know, not too far from this very spot across the river in New Jersey, ABC Sports launched the Professional Bowlers Tour 30 years ago. As America expanded westward, so too did bowling. And speaking of west, well, that's the direction I'm heading.
Here's at Gable House, the 11th year for the AC Delco Classic and our 30th anniversary season. 17 years for me in the announce booth with Chris Schenkel, and I've enjoyed many of the moments on ABC television as all of the fans. The 5-300 games we've had on ABC over the years, the 2-7-10 split conversions, and 1992 looks like it's going to be a banner year. There's a lot of new faces out here, some of the top veterans are back, and Chris Schenkel, we have more than $3 million available for the players in the next 4 months.
Out of the total purse money of $177,500, $37,000 will go to the winner 19, 12, 9, and 7. So it's going to be a rewarding afternoon for all five, especially, though, for the man that will emerge as the AC Delco champion. And the current, just-announced Rookie of the Year, you're looking at him, he is 23-year-old Ricky Ward, from North Fort Myers, Florida. He'll settle for that little 3-5, and oh, he'll looks a little nervous, and what rookie isn't?
Well, Chris, he's only made one championship round before. That was in El Paso, Texas, and he bowled very well. That was last summer. He shot a 222 game and lost, but he's a coming star out here on the Pro Bowlers Tour, and a lot of the players were talking about Ricky Ward as being a top lefty.
And last year, in his rookie year, he earned $24,000. Third was his high finish in El Paso. Now, here he comes. the most flamboyant, extremely intelligent, very, very talented Marshall Holman. What a champion. Now get this, 107th time on television, Bo.
Tremendous record getting there, has struggled on the tube, though.
He has not won in his last 16 television appearances. His record is 11 wins, 16 losses.
Marshall Holman, bowling's all-time leading money winner. Ideal style, five-step delivery, stays very low, steady head, cupped wrists, arm swing right in line. Good lift out over the foul line, and this particular shot gets a real good break as the two-pin falls down, and he only has the eight-pin, the full approach.
Covers it beautifully, the man that finished third here last year. In the years since Gable House has been a host, he has done $47,000 in earnings. Coming up following us, ABC's Wide World of Sports returning with a season's premiere. Well, it's one of my favorites, always has been, always will be. The United States Figure Skating Championships presented by Diet Coke and NutraSweet. We'll see the top male skaters compete for the crown. That's live this afternoon, along with ice dancing. Later tonight, the ladies compete for the crown. All live, 9 Eastern. And that's what Marshall was looking for. Get that first strike coming in the second frame, whereas his opponent, Ricky Ward, now will move over to the right lane, and he has a spare working. Mark McDowell, who meet the winner, is warming up off to our right. That's the pinfall you hear. So a little 3-9 on the right lane, Bo.
3-9, a tough spare for Ricky Ward. As you see his approach, four-step delivery. Pretty nice style. He likes that outside line, but it swings right in line with his target. He's going to try to swing it out over the first arrow, get it out to about the second or third board, and bring it back. Doesn't quite make it back up. 3-9, tough spare.
All right. Interesting field of finalists. Three rookies of the year. Marshall Holman with 21 championships, and as Bo indicated, the number one money winner. And this is the only non-winner in the group of five, Ricky Ward. And it was here in 1987, Bo, at Gable House, when Pete McCordick, 300 to Wayne Webb's 249, and Wayne is our tournament leader.
See what Holman does on the right-hand lane, Chris. He's made, as you said, for over $47,000 at Gable House without a win. This is his seventh championship round appearance on lanes 13 and 14, this 40-lane establishment. Now Marshall takes the full approach, all 16 feet, good long slide at the line.
Right. Looking better. He talked very well earlier. We asked the veteran Marshall Holman to describe for us what his goals are for 92.
Well, for 1992, I'd first like to become a little more the bowler I used to be. I wasn't very consistent in the last few years, and I'm off to another good start in 92, and I'd like to keep it going, make plenty of telecasts, win a few tournaments, and try and get back to number one.
And for Holman, he's always bowled well. His downfall has been the championship round. As many times as he's made it, over 100 times, he doesn't have a very good record.
So after a re-rack, he has left a wobbly two-pin on the left lane. 12-pin lead going into this frame at the Gable House.
You consider Marshall Holman in the championship round over all the years, as you see his full approach, has only averaged 201, where his average on the tour is about 215. You see him coming in light, leaving the two-pin, an easy spare. If he converts that, he will lead by 11.
All right, here at the AC Delco Classic, Marshall Holman is in the lead by 12 pins. We'll be back.
Here at 13 and 14 here at the Gable House Bowl, a pair familiar to the pros. Oil 28 feet down the lane. It is carried down to 45 feet the back end of the lane. out to the channel, trying to swing it into the pocket, Chris. There's a potential for some big scores on this pair.
So now in your 18th year, your artistic talent is beginning to show.
Well, they almost kicked me out of kindergarten for my coloring, Chris, so it's got to improve sooner or later.
Your finger painting is doing okay, pal.
Now Ricky Ward with a double can cut the lead of Holman's down to one pin.
Okay. Gutsy performance by Ricky Ward, who had an outstanding year in 91, and he thinks there's more to come in 92.
Well, Bo, in 1991, I set a goal to achieve rookie of the year, and I did. In 1992, my immediate goal is to win my first title, then go on for bowler of the year. And, Mom, I'd like to wish you a happy birthday.
Well, Mom, your son can take the lead if he strikes with his third consecutive strike in the fifth frame.
He'll just sort of nonchalantly walks away, but it's that a difficult spare for a left-hander, Bo?
You're right, Chris. The 2-7, especially the big hook that Ricky Ward throws, can be difficult. He lost that ball in the bottom of the swing, and he needs to get that ball over there between the 2 and the 7, let the ball deflect into the 7 pin. Cut the hook down.
All right.
Air ball.
Air ball. And Marshall Holman of old would have jumped on this situation. Let's see if he can do it now after watching the miss.
One of the most errant shots I've seen in a while. A little nervous. Ricky Ward playing the big hook has given a big impetus to Marshall Holman.
Okay. And he jumped on it. That's a Marshall Holman of old that Bo and I have seen. They excelled at 21 wins.
Here's how Marshall Holman is attacking the championship pair. He's going to start right about the center of the lane on the back of the approach. Now, Marshall takes the full approach. We'll start back in here. He'll slide up in an area right around here, and he'll try to get the ball out between the first and second arrow, swinging wide to the pocket. We'll see how he comes and attacks the championship pair.
For a 27-pin lead right here. Has it. Sally was bowling today for his sister, Tracy. Now, Ricky Ward, after an open frame, trailing by 27. Seven pin. The crowd is really with it here at Gable House. A lot of, as we go along in the tour, Bo, 16 winter tour cities, you'll find a great number of people that are pulling for the rookies, pulling for those that haven't won yet. Isn't it great?
I think the role of underdog is somewhat advantageous with the crowd, but then a perennial favorite like Holman, who has the experience, has the advantage.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, Marshall, because of his flamboyance, has had people that have been negative about him, but I think he's the greatest.
He's winning them all over. Now let's take a look at how Ricky Ward is playing the championship here. The lefty is going to stand right about here. He walks almost perfectly straight, has a real nice approach, and his angle is going to be right out around the first arrow. He's going to swing that ball wide out by the channel. Let's watch how he does it.
Okay, we're at the AC Delco Classic. The site is the same since 1988, the Gable House. We'll be back. It's competition, Wide World next. Our first stop on a tour of 16 cities, the Professional Bowlers Association Tour in its 30th birthday year. Marshall Holman, champion, 21 times. Has a lead by 27 pins. And with that strike, leads by 37 as we join Nelson, Bo.
Thank you, Chris Schenkel. Mark McDowell, looks like Marshall Holman will be your opponent. And he's one of your idols. You have any fear against going against the idol and the all-time leading money winner?
Not really, no. I enjoy bowling Marshall. You know, he brings the best out in you. You bowl the best and it brings it out in you. He beat me here last year, so I'm looking for a little payback today.
All right, he wants to pay Marshall back, but Marshall's still got some work in front of him, Chris.
Now he's carefully, his preparation is about as meticulous and careful as any of the professionals you see. He's got a three-bagger up there, and now can increase his lead to 47. All right. He was a big leader earlier in this competition, earlier this week. Then he faltered, especially yesterday. He said he was terrible.
Well, Chris, he led the qualifying by over 300 pins, and in his first match game, he bowled 147 and followed it up with a 289. So Holman can get hot. Right now, Ward has to get hot, or he's out of the woods.
Beautiful strike. Beautiful strike. ABC's Professional Bowlers Tour heads to Las Vegas. That's right, a week from today, the best in the business will take aim at the $175,000 pot awaiting them in the Showboat Invitational. Live at 3 Eastern, 2 Central, and 3 Pacific. Next Saturday on ABC Sports, that's Brian Boss, our cover boy.
David Ozio, the Bowler of the Year, both won the AC Delco Classic and the Showboat last year. And now for Ricky Ward. He has a potential 232. Holman going at a 239 pace. Ward must strike on this ball to have any chance.
Leaving a 7 pin. Our winter schedule is highlighted by the $300,000 Firestone Tournament of Champions, $60,000 the winner. And then the other two parts of the Triple Crown, the $200,000 PBA National and the $225,000 United States Open.
Ward, the best he can do is 211. It's not going to be enough against Holman today.
Just does get it. Ricky Ward of North Fort Myers, Florida.
Holman, a potential 269.
The Open champion, the Firestone champion. That's more like it. And once he gets in the groove, physically and mentally, I might add, mentally has been a big part the last couple of years, Bo.
Well, there's no doubt, Chris. In 1983, Marshall Holman went one win and 15 losses in the championship round, and you just can't do that. He is obviously one of the greatest bowlers that ever lived, but you have to be a long-distance runner all week long and bowl those 42 games to get there. And then you got to be a sprinter on Saturday. Marshall looks like he has it today.
Marshall bowled one of five perfect 300 games here. Bruce Hamilton, Mark McDowell, Scott Craigie, and Eric Torkel. Okay, we've got a winner, and it'll be Mark McDowell stepping in against the veteran Holman, the president of the PBA, and one of the kings, Marshall Holman. We'll be back.
The Pro Bowlers Tour, brought to you by AC Delco Automotive Parts. AC Delco, it's like buying time. By Bud Light, everything.
It is a beautiful day in Southern California, and it was quite a match for Marshall Holman. He defeated Ricky Ward, the rookie of the year, 258-201, including eight strikes. So now it's against the president of the PBA, Mark McDowell, a native of Wisconsin. And as McDowell said to Bo earlier, he wants to get back at Mr. Holman. I'm Chris Schenkel, Nelson Burton Jr., and our first stop on a tour of 16 cities here in California. As we have for 30 years, we've been the lead-in show for a great ABC 1-2 punch. Wide World of Sports follows us again today, and what a blockbuster show. Wide World season begins with the men's and ice dancing finals live of the United States Figure Skating Championship. Christopher Bowman in the lake, Mark Mitchell, Scott Davis, and Paul Wiley. That is the standing going into the finals this afternoon, immediately following us. But if that isn't enough, later tonight, as you look at Christy Yamaguchi, the reigning world champion who has never won the United States Championship, she's in the lead, followed by Nancy Kerrigan and Tonya Harding. So tonight, live at 9 Eastern, 8 Pacific, and 9 Central, will be the finals of the ladies. And
well, Chris, you know, Wide World of Sports has been a tradition here for 30 years or 30-plus years on ABC. And another tradition has been the Pro Bowlers Tour with Chris Schenkel for 30 years. And
as a fan of Chris Schenkel and for the employees of ABC Television, I'd like to thank you for the many thrills and the announcing you've given us over 30 years, and even more so for the 40 years as a broadcast network announcer. That's a lot of years to be on top of the heap, and 50 years in the television business as a broadcaster, Chris. Your golden anniversary. You're truly a great man, and you have set the benchmark by which all announcers shall be judged, and I congratulate you.
I thank you, and I have the best teammates in the world, I'll put it that way. I sort of cringe when you say a half century. That's a long time, isn't it? Our president, Dennis Swanson, is rapidly learning that. He's been in the business 33. So, Dennis, you have 17 to go. Then you can catch up. But I've enjoyed every year, every telecast. Let's get on with the show, shall we?
All right, let's see if Mark McDowell can vindicate himself of that loss of Marshall Holman here at the AC Delco Classic last year. Two experienced players.
And Marshall will be shooting first. There you see Mickey Kogan on the right. He manages Gable House, owned by his father and his wife, Laura. They're expecting their third child very soon. And Brandon Kogan is next to Laura. And then Kevin Kogan, the IndyCar driver, and his wife, Tracy. The family's here. High hit. Marshall says, okay, 3-6-10.
Well, let's see, Chris, and you alluded to it in the first game. If Holman can keep the consistent concentration out there, he sees off on this first shot. He pulls the ball right in between the second and third arrows. Holman's target is outside the second arrow. He pulls it inside the second, so conversion of the 3-6-10. Holman, a great spear maker, but he makes it a lot different than a lot of other players. He used a little top spin shot to make the ball go straight.
At the line, almost a gymnastic event. Marshall was the body English all over the place, but he did cover and marked with a spare. If you just joined us, he won the first match over Ricky Ward, 258-201. Now, Mark McDowell, 29 years old. The two-time champion puts on the heat.
Here's a player who has just gotten better and better. Five-step delivery, very short, powerful legs, cupped wrist, lofts that ball well out over the foul line, and he's playing the big hook today. He has the luxury of being able to throw it fairly straight when he needs to or really hook it, so he's gone with the big hook. Now the grip of Mark McDowell, the fingertip grip, the fingers inserted down to just the first knuckle, then he'll cup it on the top of the backswing, hopes to open with a double.
Of loss. The Prexy is ready, isn't he?
He came out swinging. See how Holman reacts to it. First place, Marshall made a bad shot in the first frame, and let's see if he reacts to that double of Mark McDowell's.
Marshall Holman at 8 in the first game, bowling at 258. Today, as we begin a new season of bowling, let's talk about tomorrow. It'll be golf's turn as we present the season opener of the PGA Tour. Top players in the 1991 Tour tee off in the final round of the Infinity Tournament of Champions, live at 3 Eastern, 2 Central, 2 Pacific. That's tomorrow, ABC Sports. Remember televising the first one, Bo, at the Desert Inn in Las Vegas. Ooh, now. A little split shooting coming up, Marshall Holman.
Holman's soft with his speed there. He didn't pull that shot, so that's two bad shots on the left-hand lane. What he needs to do is, after he gets that ball to the right of the lane, needs to get that ball over in the 2-7 area and slide that ball back into the 10. See how he does it. Three is taken out by the ball. Ball takes out the 10. Holman needs to make this to keep some pressure on Mark McDowell.
First one all week. He looks up at us and tells us, first one all week. Well, it looked perfect.
I met Mark McDowell doing an exhibition in Madison, Wisconsin a few years back, Chris, and afterwards he asked me about the Pro Bowlers Tour. We got a sponsor lined up for him, a young lady, and he's been rolling ever since, and right now he can roll to a 20-pin lead over Holman with another strike.
Oh, yes. Maturity and discipline. That's the way Mark likes to be described. But he described earlier that... Wait just a moment before we get to the answer to his question.
He slides very close to the foul. And watch the 2-pin go to the sideboard. Trip out the 4, come around, take out the 9-pin. A great break for Mark McDowell in the third frame. Can he capitalize it and let him go to a 30-pin lead?
Remember this tune recorded by the Tokens, which topped the charts 30 years ago this week? Listen.
New commissioner, Mike Connor. We welcome him and we wish him good luck. And we also thank and praise Joanna Nora, who led the PBA for a long time. Marshall Holman. Started bowling at 12. Had as his idols Carmen Salvino, Dick Weber, and Harry Smith. Watching them on this show. Speaking of this show, as we look at Marshall... I have always been a music fan, especially jazz piano, but my favorite Metropolitan Opera star is Robert Merrill. Saw him recently and said, when does the series start? He is an avid watcher of our series. And he knows about missing 10 pins, just as Marshall did. Because Robert Merrill and his wife have bowled and watched the show. There go again, Marshall, sometimes losing that concentration. The last few years, hasn't won since 1988. 17th time on TV since that last victory. It was the United States Open at Edmond. Didn't come up, leaving the bucket. So this second game is just proving a huge problem for Holman, because Mark McDowell has opened with 4. Let's see what he does with 2, 4, 5, 8. Coming into that frame, trailing by 42. Won his first game, 258 to Ricky Ward's 201. There it could be the undoing, the ungluing as we lead the bow.
Thank you, Chris. Rick Steelsmith in the number 2 position. Rick, you've been compared to Marshall Holman, and he struggles on television, and looking at your record, you haven't quite averaged 200 on television over the last couple of years. Do you have any changes in store for today?
Really, today I'm just going to go out and be aggressive and try to do the same things I did all week. Previous TV shows, I was tired at the end of the week and didn't make good shots on TV, and today I'm going to go out and do that.
He says he's well-rested and he's ready to go, Chris. We'll see you in about 10 minutes. Good luck, Rick.
All right. And so is this man, Mark McDowell of Madison, Wisconsin. Solid 10 after 4 in a row. He's on the right lane, going almost touching the return. Cross lane for the 10-pin. Rick Steelsmith looked ready.
Yeah, Chris, Steelsmith has always had the potential of being a great player, and he does look ready.
Earlier I mentioned maturity and discipline of McDowell. Now we hear what he has to say about what's ahead for him in the current year.
Well, I just want to keep progressing the way I have the last few years. I'd like to win a title and get back in the Firestone. On the home front, Patty and I, my wife, we're looking to buy a house in Madison, Wisconsin, and start a family. So that's ahead for 92.
Look at that. Mark mentioning the Firestone, he is the alternate in that big field.
Needs to win, and Chris, he gets what we call a paralyzer shot here. Look at the ball comes in and drives the five out, but the head pin comes off the sideboard so quickly that the action over on the left side stops the five pin from falling down. Unusual shot.
A roulette pin.
Round and round.
Pin lead by McDowell as Marshall Holman is up. Man that won $100,000 or more 8 seasons. 6 consecutive years with shots like that.
For Holman, the key for him is obviously he has to strike trailing by 40 pins. As you see the angle that Holman attacks the lane with, starting around the middle of the lane out to about the third board. But the key for Holman here as he comes up in the seventh frame is to have that real smooth timing. If Marshall goes to the line very slow and waits for the ball, he's the toughest there is. And he needs to make some shots like that to close the gap on McDowell.
There he goes. All right, we're in our second match. The winner of the first, you're looking at him, Marshall Holman, but trailing here against Mark McDowell. More after this. Following the professional bowlers tour, we're in our second game. We're at the Gable House in Torrance, California. Mark McDowell leading by 30 pins now as Holman has doubled to make a comeback with a spare up. Here's McDowell, seventh frame. Defending his territory, McDowell, who opened with 4 in a row.
McDowell, who's throwing the ball a lot like Mark Roth when Roth was going very hot, has the big loft on the ball. And he holds that hook down and then breaks it very sharply at the back end. Now we'll see how Mark McDowell is attacking the championship here. He's going to be right about the center of the approach. He's going to walk slightly to his left. His target's going to be right around the second arrow and swing that ball real wide with a big loft. Watch that ball go over the foul line about 3 or 4 feet.
Came up high. Boy, did he want that strike.
McDowell's going to struggle for a couple of reasons, Chris, and I tell you what, Marshall Holman will see it too. As you see him going high here, two things are happening. He's hooking the ball a lot, so he's having to throw very, very hard. You can throw the ball right through the break. Secondly, he's having trouble getting out of the thumb hole, and that's disaster for the confidence of a pro bowler, especially in a championship round. So there's a lot of match left.
Okay. During the week, Pete Weber finished 45th, Curtis Odom, Pete was 41st, Odom 45th, Harry Sullins and Tony Westlake 43rd, and Bob Benoit 49th.
Top players, Mike Albee got the last check, 53rd. Now Holman can cut the lead to 20. Big shot, 8th frame.
Disappointment, hitting 3-6 on the right lane. Our statistician scorer today is Del Ballard, who finished 8th. Filling in for Butch Soper, who's ailing. We wish him speedy recovery.
You bet. A lot of people have the flu. It's all over the country. Now Holman, who let McDowell off the hook, has a tough spare. Indecision, Chris. You know, we saw him step down on the ball return and pick up another ball to shoot that spare with. Then he decided to use his strike ball and throw the big hook at the 3-6. He paid the maximum penalty, chopped the 3 off the 6, and put himself in dire straits because the best he can do is 2-0-4. McDowell going at a 2-28 pace.
Two open frames in the second game following a big victory in the first. Marshall is 37 years old. As you said, 21 wins in an 18-year career in the PBA. Rick Steelsmith is waiting. David Ozio, who is here, is the PBA Player of the Year with $225,000 total, followed by Mazza, Monticelli, Del Ballard, whom we talked about a moment ago, and Pete Weber. And the average leaders, 218 for Norm Duke, Weber in second, Walter Ray, Ozio, and Mazza.
All those players are back on the tour at 92.
Leaving a 10 pin. So the president wins. President of the PBA, youngest ever, 29 years old.
Holman looks good, though.
I think he has
a better attitude this year than I've seen in years. He bowled a good first game, kind of lost his speed control in the second game, but never count him out. He'll be back, but we'll get to see Mark McDowell take on Rick Steelsmith in the semifinal.
Two collegians. Bo brings us up to date on the American Bowling Congress's rules concerning lane oil application. It's a complicated subject. We hope for a good game between Steelsmith and McDowell soon. Stay with us.
On January 1st, 1992, the American Bowling Congress, the ruling body of all bowling, made it mandatory that oil be applied gutter to gutter on every bowling center to make it fair for everyone. Now, the American Bowling Congress has a system to check the lanes. Basically, they take up oil in three different spots on the lane, put it on a piece of tape, which eventually will show us exactly how the lane is oiled. The tape is run through a simple machine, which tells us how much oil is applied from gutter to gutter. After that is run through the machine, it's put on a chart. This chart basically is off this lane. It says, look, there's oil from channel to channel or gutter to gutter, a little higher concentration in the middle. This lane is legitimate. Remember, the American Bowling Congress is out there to serve you and make the game better for all of us.
No better way to face the day.
You too will enjoy the perfect game bowling. We've had two good ones here today in the AC Delco Classic. 258 to 201, Marshall Holman winning it with eight strikes. Van faltering in the second, but a good job by Mark McDowell defeating Holman 228 to 184. And that means now McDowell will go against another former Rookie of the Year and another collegian, Rick Steelsmith. So the two collegians are head-to-head coming up. Our next two stops, a week from today, will be at the Showboat for the finals of the Showboat Invitational. Long-time stop on the PBA Tour. That's $175,000 total. And then 2 weeks from today, back to California for the ERC Sacramento PBA Open. Those are the next two stops. Bo?
Sacramento, I'm looking forward to that, Chris. And here's the field this week. 160 players, good average, 206, 217 to make the top 24. Firestone Tournament champions, Ferraro is in there. Eric Forkel, solid lefty. The man who made gutter balls famous, Del Ballard. Mike Shady, excellent player in ninth. Watch Hamilton, he's a good young player. Parker Bowen up there. Tommy Kreitz, the smooth stroker. Dan Nettarelli had a good week. Great experience for him. Dave D'Intermont, the powerful guy. Watch this Watka guy. He looks good. Ron Palumbo, U.S. Open champion. Thomas had a good week in 17th place. Joe Salvemini, the smooth-stroking left-hander, and the fireballer, Phil Ringeter, in 19th. Steve Wunderlich, he's in shape this year. He says it's going to be his last year. He's going to make the most of it. Norm Duke up there. Berg, I had a good week. Gwinden, the big, powerful player in 23rd place. And Don Johnson's son, Jimmy Johnson, Hall of Famer, rounds out the top 24. And, Chris, we have a great semifinal match coming up.
We really do. Two former Rookies of the Year, McDowell in 1986, and in the multicolored shirt, Rick Steelsmith of Wichita in 1988. College graduates.
Chris, if you have to pick a favorite, look at their championship round averages. Rick Steelsmith has only averaged 191, where Mark McDowell 217. Both young collegians, as you say, but McDowell has been much more successful on television.
For McDowell, his 16th appearance on television. For Steelsmith, his 7th. So it's a two-pin, that single pin for McDowell. Remember, we've had pins missed today. And even though they are the world's finest professionals, they too make errors, but they recover. Okay, we'll see Steelsmith in a moment. Here's Bo.
Thank you, Chris. Marshall Holman, two good games. The first one, excellent. The second game, you're a little off on your speed control. What's happening out on the championship here right now?
Well, the Orioles continue to carry down a little bit, Bo. The left lane started getting a little bit tighter, and that's why I was kind of not trusting it and going a little bit high. So these guys can handle it. They're both seasoned veterans, and even though Ricky hadn't been out that long, he's a hell of a player.
But Steelsmith has really struggled in championship round appearances, and I don't want to bring up a bad subject, but that's what you've struggled with. Can you give him any advice?
Maybe he hooks the ball too much.
All right. Good luck to him. We'll see who wins. Thank you, Marshall.
You bet, Bob.
They were talking about Rick Steelsmith qualifying second, and he has left the 3-6-10. And this in his open frame of this championship. Some distraction, some extraneous noises. It sounded like it was coming from Walkman radio.
This is the spare that Holman chopped. And Rick does the same thing. Holman had the 3-6. He played too much hook at it, chopped it off, and once again, Steelsmith off to a real shaky start. Plays the big hook on the 3-6-10. Chris, there's two schools of thoughts on the 3-6-10. Is should you go down and in where and hook it in there, or go across lane with a straighter shot? Obviously, today has proven that across lane with a very straight shot, accuracy is all is needed, is the best way to attack those right-hand corner spares.
Nice comeback, but you can never make up lost pins for an error in bowling. You can hit a next great golf shot to recover from a bad one, but in bowling, you're dead.
You're right about that, especially in a one-game match. It's like a sudden death in a golf hole. Speaking of that, this really puts the pressure on the player.
Hoping and hoping that the four pin would go.
Tough split, the 4-10, and what he needs to do is get that ball over in the left-hand side of the lane and slide that 4 in the 10. He's quickly up on the approach. He's just going to fire at it. Tough shot.
So the collegian from West Texas State, those opens.
Well, Chris, I said it last game. I believe that McDowell's going to have some trouble when he's pressured, and he really wasn't pressured there by Steelsmith, but he's throwing so hard and is playing such a tremendous hook, and finally the last little chink in the armor is hanging in that thumb hole. He's unsure when he's going to get out of it. If he doesn't make some sort of adjustment, he's going to struggle against Steelsmith. Well, for a player, when he hangs in the thumb hole, you can either take a little tape out or throw the ball a little bit slower, or he has the option of getting another bowling ball. A player is allowed 8 bowling balls in the Pro Bowlers Tour, so if McDowell feels that he has no chance at all, he should reach down and get another ball before Steelsmith gets away from him.
Leaving a four-pin, a young man, 27 years of age, but what experience, including international, in the FIQ, won gold medals all over the place, with a style like this.
Chris, ideal 5-step delivery, steps left on his last step, tremendous wrist action. I tell you, he has one of the best on tour. He just needs to get his confidence going in the championship round. Right now, if he converts his spare, he will lead by one pin through 3 frames.
There it is again.
Well, he's shooting the ball down the left side, and he doesn't know what's on the left sideline. Look at the position that Rick Steelsmith takes on the lane. He starts the ball. Look at down the left side. He's a right-handed bowler. That's where Ricky Ward should be. The lefty was in the first match. You can't consistently go down the left side and know what the ball is going to do, and it ran away from him. Two major mistakes, but yet he's still in the match because McDowell is struggling.
Actually, trailing by only 11. Who was better? Man that won the ABC Masters as an amateur, which is an incredible feat. Trailing by 11, we're in our third match, the semifinal. More of it following this. Schedule as we look at Rick Steelsmith. Rick was hoping for a strike there. He had one working for him. While we were away, Mark McDowell continued on with a strike up on the fourth. He doubled, so he's out to a 21-pin lead. He has a three-bagger going for him. Now it's a 31-pin lead for McDowell. And there you see the cluster. It's the 3-6 9-10. Well done. Bowie paid a little more attention that time.
You're right, Chris. The 3-6-9-10, you converted it finally. Wayne Webb, our tournament leader, you're the veteran. You have two guys who only had a couple years' experience out there. What's your game plan for whomever you bowl?
I just got to get out, and I feel as if I make good shots, I'll be able to strike a lot, and that's all I'm going to work on right now.
Well, they shot 300 against you last time you were in a championship round here, and you only bowled 249. You think that's enough to win?
Well, 249 should be enough to win, but it's my turn to shoot the 300.
All right. He predicts a big score. Chris, we'll know in about 10 minutes. Back to you.
Okay, for Rick Steelsmith, a strike in the sixth frame, and he is trailing by 31. The leader in the yellow shirt, Mark McDowell, who defeated Marshall Holman a little earlier, 228 to 184. Holman winning the first game over Ricky Ward, 258 to 201. Wide World follows up. Us, that's next. Season's premiere with the United States Figure Skating Championships, presented by Diet Coke and NutraSweet. Top male skaters going for the crown live. There will be ice dancing as well. And then tonight, the ladies take over. Look at them. Yamaguchi, who is the leader, followed by Nancy Kerrigan and Tonya Harding. That's at 9 Eastern, 8 Central, 9 Pacific. Double whammy with Wide World today and United States Figure Skating.
McDowell can extend to 51 pins.
Sending a message to Wayne Webb. 51-pin lead. Look at that intensity on the face.
He's focused, so is this young man, who's had Olympic training. He bowled for our United States team. He had the luxury of going to Colorado Springs and going through the Olympic Training Center, and he says the most training was really in concentration and confidence.
Okay, we're in our semifinal game. Soon we'll return for more of it.
They hate the same.
Comfortable lead by Mark McDowell, who got into the semifinal game by defeating Marshall Holman. He has some fans here.
Well, he's really doing very well, Chris. We were a little skeptical on how well he'd do, and he strung six strikes in a row here with a lot of speed and a lot of power, and he's freewheeling. He's got Steelsmith on the ropes.
Last year, seven championship round appearances, earning $94,000. And starting 92 off in great fashion. Finishing third in our field of five, and now in the semifinal, looks as though he's well on his way to getting into the final against Webb.
Lock City, potential 267 for Rick Steelsmith. He has a potential 205. He's just struggled here on the right-hand lane, but he looks fairly sharp. He'll be back.
Rick had to lay out a year, a rotator cuff shoulder surgery and rehabilitation.
Well, he was out almost 18 months with that, Chris, and obviously, he had an operation on it, and he says it's okay now. He's using a 15-pound ball, but he can practice. He put a lot of practice in November, December, and he's ready for the tour. He's ready to win, although he struggled a little bit today.
such a stylist. McDowell is the winner. ABC Sports presentation of the Professional Bowlers Tour will return after this message and a word. We're back again at Gable House in Torrance, California. Since 1988, this has been the site of the AC Delco Championship. Today, the winner in the next game will get $37,000. And that battle will take place between the tournament leader, Webb, and McDowell. You see the previous scores. Holman winning the first in big way, 258-201. Then had trouble against Mark McDowell, 228-184. And now McDowell, 241, seven strikes, and strangely enough, the loser at eight. Well, nevertheless.
Well, you got to fill those frames, though, right, Chris?
You really do. You got to fill them. As I indicated, we're here at Torrance, California, Gable House, which is owned by longtime friend Jack Cogan, managed by his one son, Mickey Cogan. And he has another son that I have rooted for, as many race fans have for years, Kevin Cogan, who finished second in 1986 in the Indy 500. But last year, there was a problem. ABC's coverage here, produced by Bob Goodrich, who's joined us today, shows you Kevin having some problems. And believe me, you can't imagine what damage was done to his wonderful young California body. Multiple fractures on the right side, and we're glad you're here, Kevin. How you doing?
Yeah, I'm getting better. It's just taking a lot longer than I thought, and we put quite a bit of metal in there, so if any of these pin setters have a problem, I'm storing up metal for the family. But other than that, it's taking a lot longer than we thought. It's just a very slow healing process because there were so many fractures.
Down the road, have you looked far ahead to maybe get back on the wheel?
Well, you know, we had the second fastest time of May last year, and I was fifth fastest on the grid even after blowing an engine in qualifying. And Menard has asked me to come back for next year, so I'm really looking forward to it. Trying to do the physical therapy every day, like as much as I can.
20 breaks alone just from his elbow up to his shoulder on his right side, it makes me cringe. But we want you back healthy, and we want you back racing because it's your first love, other than Tracy.
It's an addiction is what it is.
I know what you mean. Okay. And, of course, the 76th running of the Indianapolis 500 will be seen again live, exclusive coverage, on May 24th. We'll be there. We hope you will join us if you can't make it to the track. Bo's going to go this year. Okay, we're ready for that championship, Max. Thank you very much, Kevin, and good luck. Wayne Webb, the tournament leader, now comes in going against Mark McDowell.
Mark McDowell, who needs to win this game to qualify for the Firestone Tournament of Champions, the 16th and final stop on the winter tour, against the veteran Wayne Webb, who has only won once in the last 7 years.
All right, Mark McDowell. He's won two titles, teaming up with Dick Weber in a senior touring pro doubles. Won his first title in Fresno. Now Webb. That's a new Wayne Webb style.
Oh, you're right about that, Chris. Wayne Webb, for years, we always saw him hold the ball down low, take a five-step delivery. Now he's holding it up waist high, six-step delivery, says it helps his timing. All the rest is the same, the good pivot step, the tremendous wrist action. I think Wayne Webb has always had one of the best arm swings and best releases in the sport of bowling, as evidenced by he's going over $1 million today.
And leaving a 10-pin. Seldom shows reaction. He probably has had more residences than any of our professionals in the PBA. Started out in Rehoboth, Massachusetts, and I know that well because I used to announce midget racing in that area. And he's been in Indianapolis. He's been in Tucson, Albuquerque, now, of course, Beaumont.
Well, it's important for McDowell to get out to a quick start. Wayne Webb is one of the tough clutch players on the tour and can throw a lot of strikes, so it behooves Mark McDowell to get off to a quick lead. He started with a strike, would like to make it a double.
Remember we said that the winner, 37 today, the runner-up, 19,000. So right in this very match, they're battling for 56,000. First stop in a tour of 16 cities, our 30th birthday year. And there's the PBA Player of the Year. What a year last year, David Ozio.
He was named Player of the Year last week by the constituents and his peers on the PBA Tour. Ricky Ward, who was in our first match, was named Rookie of the Year. Ozio, a great player, is the defending champion next week at the Showboat.
And a year ago, he won right here.
The loft of McDowell, the wide swing. Watch him send it out wide.
So in this battle, we have a 34-year-old named Wayne Webb bowling out of Beaumont and going against a 29-year-old, Mark McDowell. There's a good look at Wayne. He can concentrate when he needs to, I'll tell you.
Well, both players have left a solid 10-pin. An apparent good hit on the left-hand lane has stopped their strikes. So it's tit-for-tat so far, but slight advantage to McDowell by 9 pins if he converts because he started with the double.
Wayne's last win was at Landmark Lanes in Peoria, the True Value Open. And just a little reminder that should we get a perfect 300 game, not today, but no chance in this match, 100,000 by True Value, 200,000 in Peoria. So it's a 7-pin.
Well, Webb is keeping to his game plan. He's said, I'm going to keep the ball around the pocket. If I can hit the pocket, he trusts his strike ball. He does have one of the best strike balls ever in professional bowling. And he's been strike, 10-pin, strike, 7-pin. So Webb is doing what he planned to do, and he's not out of the match.
Wayne Webb will pass the $1 million earnings mark today. His sights are set high again for 92. Listen.
Well, I'd really like to get my career going again. I started working out and trying to lose some weight and practicing a lot, just trying to stay real sharp.
Well, he looks as sharp as ever, Chris.
And, yes.
I think he's rededicated himself. Wayne Webb is a young man, 34, and this is when he can be his best.
Leaving a 4-pin, and his father was his inspiration as a youngster to bowl. And, Bo, you can relate to that with your Hall of Fame dad. That was the tiger that got you started.
You're right. My dad got me started, and Wayne Webb started bowling duck pins at the age 3. Was a 120 duck pin average bowler, as you see the concentration on Mark McDowell's face. Both players deep in concentration. That's what it takes to be a winner at this level.
Okay, we're in our AC Delco Championship match. 11-pin lead by Mark McDowell. We'll be back. Beck and the trophy, along with Mickey Kogan. Okay, the leader, Mark McDowell.
Leads by 11, fourth frame. Look at that ball turn left down there. That ball went 45 feet down the lane and just put on the left turn signal and just set right up in the pocket. Watch this quick transition right there. Now, boom, looks like it hit a brick. Bounce right back into the pocket. I don't think I've ever seen a ball take that quite that sharp of turn to the pocket, Chris. Even the big hook ball players, he really has it going.
Maybe Bill Lillard.
Could have been, but he was more of a curve, Chris.
Well, that's true.
That was such a sharp turn. The ball traveled about 2 feet on the lane and turned over about 6 inches. That's a lot.
Amazing, wasn't it? And that one lacked a little, didn't it?
You're right. And there is the idea of not getting out of the thumb hole clean. I have to give Mark McDowell credit. He has struggled with that thumb hole a little bit all week long, especially today, but he's made the best of it. He keeps making good shots. There he slides by the head pin. He leaves the 2-8, gets a great break as the 2-pin falls out and makes it an easy spare. And he can maintain his lead of 11 pins. Full fingertip grip.
Wayne Webb is up. Wayne, 17 titles in as many years as a member of the PBA. A 1980 Player of the Year, won the 1980 Firestone. Trailing by one. 11. 6.
He got a good break there. He threw the ball way left of his target. Breaks down the 4-7. The pin, 3-pin pops out the 10. Has a simple spare, the 6-pin. And he's not out of this match. Through 5 frames, trails by 12. And this is where Webb has to turn it on, Chris. I think he has the experience. He has to forget that bad shot. I think one of the hardest things to do is get to the championship round, and then once you get there, don't dwell on your mistakes. Now let's see how he's playing the championship here. Wayne Webb doesn't play much hook at all on this lane here. He's starting the center. He'll slide about here. He'll try to get it right between the first and second arrows. Pretty much the same shot we've seen all the players all day long. Just send it wide.
Just did not come up the 1-2-10.
Trouble. He just quit on the shot. He needs to get that ball left of the head pin. Get that ball over left of the head pin. Right in here, slide that head pin into the 10. Keep the pressure on Mark McDowell.
Okay, appreciative fans. What a conversion.
Beautiful. Wonder what's going through his mind, though, Chris. He was real confident as you see him convert the washout, the 1-2-10. He was real confident, and all of a sudden he's had some bad shots, and he's got to get it together.
Suffering from some of the same whatever it is, Marshall Holman. Neither having won in recent years. This...
Correct, Chris. As you mentioned, 17 titles for Wayne Webb, as you see McDowell with his best shot of the match, getting a strike here in the sixth. But if you've only won once in the last 7 years, it makes it difficult to get your mind set to win again. And McDowell, every time his opponent gives him an opening, he loosens up and takes advantage of it. He's done 2 for 2. Let's see if he does it against Wayne Webb in the championship match. He can take a 25-pin lead, seventh frame.
Leading the 2-8 on the left lane, the young man who competed in 30 tournaments last year. He cashed in 22.
Excellent. He has to get the ball over here in the 2-pin, let the ball or pin carry back into the 8. This is the first tough spare shot that Mark McDowell has faced today. Let's see how he attacks it. Big shot, doesn't want to open in the 7th frame.
Oh.
The late Billy Walu said, trust is a must or your game is a bust. And he trusted that. Look at his eyes. He said, is that ball going to hook enough to get this?
Webb with a spare working. This is a championship match if you just joined us. Holman winning the first game 258-201. Then McDowell and Holman. McDowell 228 to Holman's 184. McDowell advancing into the finals here against Rick Steelsmith, 240-205. And now his opponent is this man, Wayne Webb. Oh. 16-10 lead by McDowell over Webb.
See a lot of maturity in Wayne Webb's game. When he first came out, he had one of the strongest strike balls ever to come on the Pro Bowlers Tour. Got a lot of strikes, a lot of open frames. Look at his game here. He could have never bowled a game like this. Very cerebral game. He has a strike and then 6 consecutive spares. He's improved his spare making, but he must get some strikes to have a chance against McDowell. Just 3 frames left.
Wayne Webb. 1970 thrower to 84, either Earl Anthony or Mark Roth won Player of the Year honors, except 1980, and it was this man, Wayne Webb.
The green machine, they call him, and he says green because he's always thinking of the money. Now for McDowell, he's going at a 209 pace, Webb a possible 223. It's anybody's match, just 3 frames left.
Wow. Powerful, powerful.
Portrait of a perfect strike. Everything done according to the textbook. Good low profile, slides close to the line, swings the ball out. Ball drives through, taking out the 1, 3, 5, and 9. Those pins doing the damage. Now for McDowell, this is the biggest shot of the week. He struggled on this left-hand lane. He can put Webb on the ropes if he can strike in the ninth.
All right, there's that big double. Foundation strike. Woo.
Must strike for Wayne Webb. He has to strike here to win. No chance without it.
And do we have a fine coming up, Bo?
Well, Wayne Webb, he went very quickly, and he's put himself in real trouble here. But Mark McDowell in the ninth frame took too long, more than 25 seconds on the approach, and he was fined $100. He had the same thing happen to him here last year, but it was worth the $100, Chris, because he put the tournament away with that double. A couple of PBA rules that are a little bit different than at home, Chris. You allow two re-racks during a game, and you have exactly 25 seconds from the time the ball comes back, like right now for Wayne Webb, to start your approach. Mark McDowell went past that in the ninth frame, but he's locked up the tournament.
Wayne Webb, 4 years, over $100,000 earned.
Wayne Webb, best he can do, 192, not enough.
Week from today, it's the Showboat Invitational. Showboat Lanes in Las Vegas. 2 weeks from today, we'll be in Sacramento.
New stop in Sacramento. Great bowling town. They've spent 17 years since we've been back to Sacramento. The people are waiting.
Disappointed and expressionless Wayne Webb here as the tournament leader in the final game against Mark McDowell, who came into the final match with two wins, one against Holman and another against Rick Steelsmith. Four-seven, Wayne acknowledging appreciation extended by this standing room only crowd at the Gable House in Torrance, California. Okay, there you have the winner, $37,000. So from Torrance, California, let's go to Orlando, Florida, and here is Al Michaels.
Okay, Chris, the Orlando Arena is the site of the 19...
down the money board, Mark McDowell, third title, $37,000. Wayne Webb, 19, 12, 9, and 7. There's the winner, his third title. He's going to get a check from Frank Gone, who's assisting advertising director of AC Delco and the manager of Gable House, Mickey Kogan. Congratulations to Mark McDowell for all of us at ABC.